kids, you're about to listen to a comedy podcast. That means that none of this is medical advice. If you need medical advice and medical care, please contact your doctor. Brought to you by the Koala Cola Corporation. It tastes just like Down Under. I'm Crampy Koala. Take it away, DJ Dylan.
Welcome to the Jock Doc Corporate Company Conference, sponsored by Koala Cola. We're all here to learn. We're here to grow. But most importantly, we're here to sell some damn Koala Cola soda. Am I right? Now, let me introduce your host, Dr. London Smith.
Hello, and welcome to the Jock Doc Podcast, where we discuss fitness and health and how to incorporate our modern understanding of science and medicine into our daily lives, but without it being so boring. I'm your host, DrLondonSmith.com. I'd like to begin by apologizing to our listeners. We've received some feedback about the excessive amount of technical medical terms that I've been using, such as cytomegalovirus-induced colitis and I saw Susie sitting in a shoeshine shop. So I will try to temper my terminology to a simpler one in the future. Here to help with that is our producer, Cameron.
Hey, Dr. London, I'm surprised you're insisting on like actually trying to record an episode right now. I mean, we're kind of on our company conference.
Yes.
The Jock Doc Corporate Company Conference.
Yeah, but this is really the thing that we're working on the most, right? Like,
yeah, I guess it's true. It's applying all the stuff that we've learned over the last day and what we're going to be learning the rest of the weekend and everything and this sort of corporate retreat. I mean, do you want to sort of explain why you felt we needed to do this?
Yeah, well, so to some extent, it was my idea. I was saying, like, well, we aren't really meeting all of our quotas with the Koala Cola Corporation and the podcast network's takeover and us going under their umbrella. They had things like they really wanted us to kind of get over our 13 listener high. So they wanted us to have more than 13 listeners.
Yeah, they wanted us to climb Mount Everest, too, I believe.
Yeah. And so both of those, the latter sounded a lot easier to me, logistically.
For real.
It's like, that sounded achievable. But, so they said, more listeners first, and then we'll send you to Everest. So that's the prize, I guess, for if we pull this off, basically.
Yeah, and I don't want that prize. That's the thing. It's like, it's not motivating at all. I'm really busy.
Yeah. Well, you've been so busy with your training for it that the training has taken over.
I'm training for a way better mountain. That's why I can't even be worried about Everest right now, Dr. London.
Yeah.
It's a waste of my time, and I'm not interested in it at all. It's boring. It's the most cliche mountain to climb.
Yeah, that's true. And I mean, I guess for you, is the problem just the amount of dead bodies that are already up there?
My problem is how mainstream it is.
Okay.
Ugh. Imagine dying up there in such a cliche way on the most cliche mountain in the world.
Yeah.
And that's just you're forever. You're just, you have to haunt just like stupid tourists.
So when, do you have a preferred mountain then, or?
Yes.
Okay.
Did you want me to say it?
Well, do you want me to say it? Because you told me, but I don't know if your plans have changed.
Yeah, no, it's the Sears Tower, like in Chicago.
Yeah, okay.
I guess I just thought that was obvious.
Yeah, well, so to some people, so I know what you tweeted months ago as you were kind of working your way up and what you felt like you could manage. First, especially with the oxygen tank training you were doing, you kept saying like, well, I think I could actually handle that one really tall mountain that's under the, like in the ocean.
Oh, yeah.
There's some really tall mountain down there. And you were talking big about that. But then I guess that kind of...
Oh, yeah. And I was actually saying, like, I already did it.
Well, okay.
I just got back from climbing it. I was saying a lot of stuff that, you know, I hoped people didn't look into that much.
Yeah. Well, one basic rule that I would say, and this applies to... like any underwater mountain, is that you haven't climbed it just by being above like the elevation of that mountain.
So no, because if you this is the geography of it, Dr. London, is because so the goal of climbing Mount Everest is to be on the very tippy top.
Right. It's not the climb itself. Yeah.
If it were possible to be like a mile higher than Mount Everest, that would be the new goal that people would try to get to.
Yes.
Right. So
do you see where I'm going with that?
So Sears Tower, your plan, as I understand it, is to get a plane to fly over it, right?
Yeah, get a plane to fly to Chicago, and then I'm going to go up the elevator.
Okay.
And then I'm going to go up. I think you probably have to pay like $12 or something to go on like the observation deck.
But that's not the tippy top. Are you going to try to get up there, or is that high enough for you?
Oh, yeah. I mean, I think that counts. Like I get what you're saying. Like, is it fair to say that it's the tippy top when it's not really the tippy top? But the actual literal tippy top, Dr. London, doesn't have the binoculars that you can put a quarter in and look through.
Yeah. Okay. So that's...
And so, I mean, you'd be up there, but you couldn't even necessarily prove it without the binoculars.
Right.
Because you wouldn't be able to find a camera.
Okay. Yeah, okay. And I'm sorry. I realized that we're still getting caught up in the introductions.
Yeah, you should be sorry.
So that's our producer, Cameron. And we are, obviously doing this team building thing. Anyway, also with us is Digital in the House.
Digital in the House.
Hello. Hello, it's me, DJ Dylan, and I got a brand new dance for you. It's called the Jock Boy Slide. To the left, to the left, take it back now, y'all. To the right, take it back now, y'all. Take it back now, y'all. Clap your hands, take it back now, y'all. Spin around, stand up, sit down. Take it back now, y'all. Do a flip, do another flip. Jump into the air, do the splits. Do the splits.
Do the splits.
Today, so we are just really focused on these team building exercise, but so I have to keep us in the spirit of our usual podcast. I do have a note from corporate that they just wanted me to pass on here. So let's see. And I assume it's related to the team building, whatever. okay, so it's from our Koala Cola Corporation Stock Exchange executives. The note reads, quote, "Tell your listeners that it is safe to invest. Do not tell them that the stock prices are manipulated depending on the levels of hangriness that we feel over the lunch hour on trading day." End quote.
Oh.
So, and what's funny? We've been out here for this team building exercise for so long that I forgot all about the stock exchange that is privately run and funded by the Koala Cola Corporation.
Well, and that's the thing, Dr. London, is that, so, you keep saying just team building exercise, but we're on a corporate retreat. We're actually like up in the mountains. We were just talking about Mount Everest and everything, but we're actually like away from everything.
Yeah.
Away from the pressures of society and technology and your cell phones and whether or not my YouTube video is, faster than your YouTube video or all these different things.
Yeah.
We're actually like living life. And so when I hear these things like, oh, the stock market, should I sell or buy or sell? You know what you should do is chill.
Wow.
Leave your money. Just don't sell. Just chill and just leave it alone. Don't touch
this,
it.
So this does bring up, your TED talk that you gave on don't sell. Like, I know you're saying it like it's a zen calm thing, like we're just relaxing here. But you did speak for a full 3 hours just emphasizing on how you should not sell.
Yes, on the first night of the retreat, you know, we got everyone together in the main conference hall, and I sort of gave a rousing speech about say no to hell.
Yeah.
Don't sell.
Which, yeah, it became a rousing
and
cry.
It's just sort of saying, like, sort of condemning the idea of selling.
Mm-hmm.
And identifying it as a sort of a secret hell to even yeah. consider such a thing.
Yeah. And it really upset a lot of people because just I don't know, the exchanges and how they worked. And once again, I think the important...
A lot of people were mad because they were already there for like a Magic the Gathering
yes.
conference. Like they were... It was all one big room.
Yeah.
This is at the Super 8 conference room
motel. Yes,
yeah, up here in the mountains.
Yeah. And I'm for one thing, I can see why they gave it to us on such short notice, because I didn't realize that they had booked 13 other corporate retreats at the same
yeah.
location, the same venue. So
definitely almost felt like too short of notice, and that like the second we inquired about it, they were like, oh, yeah, hurry up. You got to pay for it. And so we like paid for it really quick. And they're like, go. And we just
sprinted.
We started it. We just went.
Yeah. And they said, like, drop those bags. So weigh you down. You got to go. And
put up the signs. Yeah. And they start handing us signs. I didn't bring any signs, but we're hanging stuff up.
Fortunately, they had some signs. They weren't specific to us. But they filled up the place, just not.
Oh yeah, they're huge.
Yeah. Oh yes, yeah, so that is what I meant. That the signs literally filled up the room. Yeah.
Yeah.
And so there, once again, it did run into some issues whenever there were 14 different corporate retreats in the same, not that big of a room.
Right.
And the signs were taking up most of the space, but I feel like we've. You know, we've made it work so far we continue to make it work because that's, of course, where we are living and sleeping as well, is this sort of open area. If you ever, like, during a national disaster, how everyone will gather into one room and just have little pallets on the ground, that's sort of the vibe here. And it's really helping us to connect in a way that the podcast hasn't before. I think.
Well, it's really good for the corporate culture.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, there are coworkers who I'm going to be honest, Dr. London, I didn't even know their names.
Yeah.
Just because, you know, like we're at the tippy top up here and we have, you know, a couple hundred employees. I can't keep track of everyone.
Oh, yeah.
But like when I, you know, when someone comes up to me and I've never even seen them before and, you know, it's Susan from accounting. And she's like, I haven't been paid in a year. What is going on? Please, what can someone address this? It's like, oh my gosh, like I'm actually like meeting a real person.
Yes.
You know what
it's
I mean?
So good. And I'm really
not
kind of
just
brushing
the celebs,
off.
Not just yeah. you, not just DJ Dylan, not the guests, but like the actual real people, and sort of seeing the things that they have to deal with.
Yeah. And it's so great to see it, sort of brush it off, and then see it from a distance. Like, and it's seeing everything from the right perspective.
Yeah.
That's what this is about. Getting away from everything, including those accountants who keep telling us that things are wrong and that we really can't, you know, get these numbers to work.
The thing that, you know, that employee Susan, she's no longer with us. She,
nope.
You know, she was unfortunately had to be let go. But I'm sure wherever she goes next, at a safe proper distance.
Mm-hmm.
I'm sure she'll thrive.
It'll be great. Yeah.
Not with this company?
Nope.
No,
not with the Jock Dog podcast in any capacity?
No. And that's, you know, I feel like this corporate retreat has been a good way to kind of get some insight into where people fit best.
Yes, I have also been categorizing everyone in our company and sort of, yeah, just putting everyone into very like tight-knit stereotypes.
Yes. Like that's the jock. That's the nerd.
Yeah.
That's the, and I don't want to, you know, body shame anyone, but that's the Chubster. You know, just this sort of way to put people in the right place just so that you can understand where they're coming from.
Exactly.
That's, empathy is the point there, you know?
Well, I mean, like, you know, for example, you were talking about jocks and, you know, they're the nerds. But like, for example, you know, Devin, Trevin, and Blevin.
Mm-hmm.
They are the stereotypical Siamese triplets.
Yes. Oh my. And it's one of those things where, for one thing, I don't know that, like, you keep identifying them as that, and I see it, but I don't want to put someone in a box at the same time, you know? So it is a sort of this walking the line, like, I don't want to see them as triplets of any kind.
Right, and that's why you put the box over them. You didn't. You were tired of seeing them. You wanted them.
Oh yeah.
Out of the way.
Yeah, it's very uncomfortable to like look at them. And that's not to be down on anyone out there who, any of our listeners who. I wonder if that's affected our numbers. If we have enough Siamese twins, or triplets who are listening.
Oh, and so it's only counting as one because they're listening to it at the same time. So they're basically stealing the show.
Yeah, I've got to let corporate know that we might have more listeners out there. I don't know.
Yeah.
In any case, I should, you know, that was, anyway, all that to say, we got that listener feedback. I do want to sort of move on to a really important part that we've been working on a lot, working on keeping it interesting and interactive and fun. It's the medical lesson, right? So Cameron, if you could,
well, do we want to gather everyone into the main hall?
Yes. Okay
for this part.
Yeah because they need to know this.
Okay, so the magic guys, they seem to be doing some sort of like a chant or something.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, and this is the Magic the Gathering, and there's also a magic man there who's doing sleight of hand. There's also a guy.
Yeah, I'm talking about the magician guys.
Yeah, there is a guy who just has like a lot of animal bones hanging from a necklace around his neck, and like a lot of I don't want to say unusual or weird, but like tattoos that I have not seen before. In any case, so they're all.
Yeah, it's all. It's panels from episodes of Rick and Morty that haven't aired yet.
Yeah.
And so just like some of the wildest.
Oh, yeah. Stuff that.
Stuff.
That's like. I don't want to, you know, be crass here, but it's kind of freaking my bean.
Yeah.
In any case. So, yep, everyone gather around. Yes, you. Do you? Nope. Okay, well, you.
Get in here.
Put the box back on. Okay.
And once you're in, you can't get out. No one's getting out until Dr. London's whatever is done. What are you doing? Was this a torture thing, or what are we doing?
It's a medical lesson. So I want.
Right. So it is the torture section. Let's go ahead and just everyone sit down.
And I want everyone to feel free to just chime in. Let me know where I can improve this. Okay. This is all about an interactive
experience. You suck.
Okay. Okay, great. So, now for today's medical lesson, cholecystocytic cysts. Cholecystocytic cysts are cystic dilatations of the biliary tree involving either the...
I don't want a cyst! Stop, don't make me have a cyst.
Okay, no,
just
so...
to work for you.
And so I should just clarify here, I'm not giving you a cyst. I know that the guy over there with the bones, he's been talking about giving people things. Like diseases and things. I'm not that. I'm not trying to do that.
Yeah, but ever since I started working for you, I started getting a lot more cysts than I had previously.
Okay, so I think you're referring to the stomach ulcers. A lot of people are stressed, and that's not my fault. Okay? That's not my fault.
I mean, Dr. Lynn, do you want to address maybe sort of the massive increase in the stomach ulcers in our company?
Yeah, so that's maybe a combination of the increased workload, with, you know, under the Qualicola Corporation, a lot of people had to take off sort of corporate jobs beyond their usual station instead of just filling out a little bit of paperwork. They are managing separate, you know, large corporate entities.
Well, and we manage, you know, workload, that phrase, in the same way that, like, ants would use that word in terms of, you know, they can carry 50 times their weight.
Yeah, and we, so believe when, we have,
you know,
the best employees.
Yes, we have a heavier workload on our employees, meaning, you know, they're not even anywhere even close to ant rank. They're just, we're just trying to get them to be able to carry two or three times their own weight.
Oh, yeah. And they, I will say, like, we think our employees...
reasonable.
We think our employees are that good. They're great. So, yeah. Be quiet, because I'm talking, but you're great. So, in any case, so, Coidocal cysts, they're in the biliary tree. That's the biliary duct that comes from the liver. They can be either extrahepatic or outside the liver, or intrahepatic inside the liver in the ducts, or both. And these choledochal cysts are commonly found in women, more likely in women. So clinical features include...
Oh, no!
Okay. Yeah.
Really? Is that why there's, like, a lot less women on this podcast than men, because so many of them have died from these cysts?
Okay, no, I should go ahead and say that how do I... so know that it's not the reason why there are less women working on this podcast. Let's clear that up.
Oh, okay. Well, that makes you feel better, I guess.
Okay. But thank you for your input, and we hope that we don't have to sort of replace you. Okay. So clinical features include epigastric pain, jaundice, fever, and right upper quadrant mass. And that's, you know, a mass on the right upper quadrant. If you look at your abdomen, it's the top right. Okay. And complications can include cholangiocarcinoma, which is actually, that's the most feared complication, with the risk being about 20% over 20 years. Other complications include...
Which quadrant is that? Yeah.
So this is all, we're looking at the upper right hand, and that's from your point of view. So if you look at your own abdomen, it's on the right side.
Uh-huh.
And it's upper.
But if I have a friend looking at it?
From their perspective, if they're looking at you and you're facing each other, it'll be the top left. It's stage right. Okay, stage right.
Yo, but what if... Okay, but what if they're looking at it through FaceTime or FaceTiming each other?
I don't remember if FaceTime mirrors, so I'm not positive about which direction.
Mm-hmm.
So I guess... a way to tell is that you would say, this is my right-hand side. Like, you'd have to say it.
I would need to know what side that they're on to even be able to say that.
Okay.
Because they're going to have to help me out.
Well, do you know your rights and lefts? So if... you know, let's put a pin in that for now, because I feel like we do have a workshop planned to work on your lefts and your rights, because that sounds like what... the issue inherently is.
No, this is that. I thought that's what this was. This is, we have this scheduled out right now. You want to look at the schedule?
Okay, yeah. Lefts.
Yeah, in the middle of your medical lesson.
It is the lefts.
It says.
And it doesn't even have the rights.
And the rights.
The rights come later, yeah. I see that that's.
That's, yeah, that's like an optional if you can possibly finish the lefts, yeah.
Okay, so if, you know what? Fine. Real quick, everyone, if you could just hold up your hands from. Okay, so you're missing a hand. You're also missing a hand. Okay. For those of you who have hands, if you could just hold up.
Everyone's just crossing their arms.
Yeah.
Sort of at a protest now.
Okay, because, so, I guess I'll say it anyway, but, like, if you hold up your hands, just hold up your index finger and your thumb out, then the one that, from your perspective, makes an L shape, that's going to be your left hand. Okay, so someone just raised their hand, and it's opposite. They obviously had a surgical, I guess, hand replacement, and it's backwards. So in your case, that rule doesn't apply. You have two right hands, and I don't... Like, that's just something you're going to have to memorize, I guess.
Oh, he has a third hand.
Yeah, okay. Yeah. So for you, you're going to... Maybe just consider having like a semi-permanent tattoo or something that tells you which side is which, or mark it sometimes. That's kind of We'll have to figure that one out separately. But thank you for... Okay. No, now he's crossing all of his arms, including the one that's growing out of his back. Okay.
Oh, yeah. And two of his arms are playing Magic the Gathering with people from...
Hey, don't mix groups. Don't mix groups.
Yeah, come on, guys.
Okay.
This is a work thing, okay? Yeah. Pay attention.
Okay. So, other complications of colorectal cysts include hepatic abscess, recurrent cholangitis and pancreatitis, rupture, biliary obstruction, cirrhosis, and portal hypertension. To diagnose, ultrasound is the best non-invasive test, while ERCP is definitive for diagnosis. Treatment is with surgery, and that's with complete resection of the cyst with a biliary enteric anastomosis to restore continuity of the biliary system with the bowels. So, it's, you know, reconnecting all of the blood vessels and everything. Okay.
And that's all that, your bowels and everything, that's in the top. That's in the top right. Quadrant.
Yeah, the upper right quadrant. You could say top right, I guess. That's fine. So we did cover the left earlier, and we do have the scheduled lecture for the right. So I don't...
I don't have the mental capacity for that today, Dr. Long.
And I was going to say, the hands don't make the letter R if you hold out your hands. So I don't... You know, I'm not sure that I
well,
can...
Well, that's actually been part of my issue with... Is that one of my hands only makes the letter R.
Oh, wow, you're... Yeah, you're right.
And so I can't. There's not, you know, there's like not anything really I can do with it. It's not super helpful.
Okay. Gotta admit that I don't run across that issue very much. But yeah, for those, you know, who can't see, Cameron is holding up his hand and it is making an R shape whenever, you're trying to make the L shape, right?
Oh, I'm just trying to just put my hand down at all.
Okay.
I'm just trying to put my hand in my pocket, Dr. Wood.
Yeah.
This is what it looks like.
Okay. Well, that's all right. So that's the medical lesson. And, so you guys don't have to disperse. You can stick around, you know. We got a full... How much longer is this retreat? I know we've been here for 4 weeks.
Yeah, and so that's 4 out of 16. So we're done with the first quadrant.
Okay. Great. So, yeah, so as we go forward here, I think one of the things we want to bear in mind is one thing that everyone here is lucky to be here. And I feel like, you know, we spent the first 3 weeks drilling that in, but some people don't seem to remember that. So let's go ahead and say out loud, I am lucky to be here. If I were not here, I would be hunted down. Yes.
Okay, I mean, you guys have to realize, you know, without the Jock Talk podcast, without, you know, Kalwala Cola, you would still be in the sewers. You know, we reached out to people in the sewers because we knew that this is where creatives go. This is where people who know how the world really operates live. And we reached out to you, and we gave you jobs.
Mm-hmm.
And we feel like some of you have sort of forgotten how, I guess...
reality works?
Well, I guess they've sort of forgotten how, like, living in the sewery they would be without us.
Well, so there's...
I'm not sure. I don't remember if that's a word, but...
Living out of the sewery? No, that's a word.
Yeah.
So... And maybe here's just a review of how that came about. We put down a net, a very generous net. Mm-hmm. We walked away. We came back. We pulled it up. You were in the net.
Yep.
We took you in. Well, not into the house, but we took you into the yard. We paid someone else to spray you down because we didn't want to be near that.
We sprayed you down. We pushed you over. We sprayed you down again.
You kept saying, that wasn't the sewer. That was just my home. I was working on cleaning the basement. And once again, we saved you.
Yes. So we played rock and roll music for you.
Well, not rock and roll. It was just the rock music, as I recall.
Yeah, it was Dwayne Johnson's his DJ music. He made that. He made an EDM song once.
Yes.
And we were playing that for you guys.
Yes. So whenever you come here and you start to say, you know, I don't care about this retreat, I don't want this job, please just give me a minimum wage. I don't care that I can't afford rent, that I need to work multiple jobs. I want anything else. I need to step in there and say, that is not what you want.
Yeah.
And you're not permitted to want that.
No, the main thing you should be wanting is to get out of the net.
Yeah.
That should be your highest priority. And so to me, it's if that's not what you're focused on, then that shows a lack of focus. That shows your inability to look at the bigger picture, which that's concerning to me
now,
from a corporate standpoint.
The reason why I haven't allowed Cameron to, like, he's been obviously been playing with that big knife, tossing it around, kind of dangling it in front of you. I don't want you touching it because I don't trust you with such a sharp item. Okay? Now, Cameron's been in charge of the knife, and he's going to stay in charge of the knife. Because we trust him with that, okay?
Yes.
I don't want you to injure yourselves, okay? So.
Me juggling two knives is safer than you using a knife to cut a sandwich. And that's just the reality of the situation. That's just because I've spent more times using a knife than I'm not using a knife.
Yeah, in a given situation, Cameron is more likely to be using a knife, whether he's opening a door, whether he's befriending a dog, anything.
Yes.
He's got a knife.
There are 24 hours in a day, Dr. London, and easily, at minimum, 12 hours and 1 second is spent with a knife in my hand.
Brushing his teeth, watching TV, all of it. It's not just knife wielding, it's knife utilizing activities.
Oh, yeah. Picking your nose with it, picking stuff out of your ear with it.
Changing the channel on the TV with it. Yeah. It's a lot of throwing the knife.
Well, and a lot of the stuff you got out of your nose and your ear gets in between the buttons on the controller, on the remote.
Right.
So you're sort of digging that gunk out.
Yeah. And that's frustrating. And these are all issues that you are well aware of, and that our employees here, they don't know, and they could be frightened by that. They could be confused by that. We don't want them to have to navigate through that.
And by them, we mean you, because that we're talking to our employees.
Yeah, well, at a certain point, I kind of don't think of them as people that I want to address directly.
Okay, so you're just talking to no one in particular, and if employees happen to hear, that would be wise of them.
If we're being honest, I'm venting at this point.
Yeah, like, this is more your diary.
Because they've been complaining about that. So, do we want to talk about sort of, you know, it, part of the whole...
What about benefits?
Yeah.
You promised benefits.
Benefits. Did I promise
that?
Okay, no. Okay, benefits. So, one of the benefits...
Yeah, because when I asked, can I at least get a pillow or something in the net? And then you were like, no, well, you were like, some benefits are coming, so you just gotta wait for it.
Yeah, so, okay, so the no pillow policy, so I thought that is, that, I didn't see an issue there. Like, what's the problem with that?
Yeah, I mean, I'm gonna guess it's, you know, sort of a first world problem. Like, people have sort of gotten equipped to having a certain luxurious lifestyle. It's sort of like deodorant, Dr. London, how, you know, we don't actually need deodorant, but we've sort of been convinced that our natural body odor is disgusting, and we have to buy this product to make it go away. And it's just sort of the same thing. Like, you don't have to sleep with a pillow. Oh, do you think a caveman had a pillow? They had a Casper pillow, Dr. London. No, they slept on a rock, just like most of our employees do.
And I will say, for those employees, you're welcome that we gave you the rocks. And to the employees who had to go out and scoop up, shovel up their own dirt to make pillows, you're welcome. You're resourceful now. You didn't have that before this retreat.
Yeah, you were living in the sewers, you know, a sewer system that, you know, would look like a normal suburban house, etc. The point being, what is our point?
So, when we go on these corporate retreats, there's more to it than just, you know, kind of connecting with ourselves. The thing is, since we started, you know, working under this umbrella of the Koala Cola Corporation, the Koala Cola Podcast Network, we haven't been managing things to the level that were expected of us. And
we have,
to some extent, I know. Yeah, I was going to say, it's not because of us, of you and me. You know, we both... I showed up on time the other day. You have before.
Yeah, well, my management style is very unique. So people have to remember that.
Right.
It's very fast.
It's very hands-off. Yeah, fast and hands-off.
Yes. No hands, everything with your face. So... moving very quickly and, like, let's say grabbing documents from the printer with your mouth.
With your face.
And then bringing it to someone as quickly as possible. No time to explain, really.
Yeah. It's based on a lot of those sort of corporate retreat style games.
Yeah.
Which I guess that's where you learned a lot of your tricks, is just you went on those retreats and you said, okay, I'm going to apply these very directly and literally to every situation.
Oh yeah, I mean, the reason we got this conference hall so cheap is because of the points I've built up, because I've been on so many of these on my own. That's just like something I like to do.
And the way you you achieved your ranking, because you're platinum ranking now, right, with your points?
Yeah, they don't, I mean, you know, the Super 8 doesn't really do platinum because they say, like, well, we've never seen that, so we can't even really prove it's real. So it's really just Bronze Plus.
Okay, but and they also haven't seen Bronze Plus either. They haven't seen Bronze before.
No. Yeah, but they're just like, you know, they've heard rumor of it.
Okay.
At least. But things like Silver, Gold, Platinum, that to them, they're like, okay, that's sort of like Greek mythology type thing.
Yeah.
Not something that exists. Let's, you know, live in reality here.
Yeah. And you know what? Let's take a moment to say thank you to Super 8. You know, we don't, you're never sure what you're going to get when you go out and travel and you go to a new place, but our venue here has been so good. The bugs have not overwhelmed us yet. And I think that's a testament.
They have unionized. The bugs have unionized and they have been chanting outside of our doors about just sort of quality of life improvements, and I side with them, truthfully.
Yeah, which I will admit that their complaints are very similar to that of our employees, to the extent that I feel like I'm torn between giving the benefits to one or the other. It's obviously leaning more towards bugs.
Our situation is different. Our employees are just don't appreciate what they're given, Dr.
Yeah,
Walton.
Which is...
they're just whiners. They're not working hard. They don't really have any sort of like vision or goals.
Mm-hmm.
They're losers, Dr. Lund. They're losers.
Yeah, and
yes,
you know, they might complain about how, you know, the urine-soaked floor. Well, soaked is the urine-flooded floor is not.
Yeah, it's standing water.
Yeah, which is why we are sitting on a stage here that we had to have built out of employees, because okay, and I'll admit this now: not all of our employees have made it through the retreat.
And we want to take a second to recognize
in memoriam.
Them.
Yes,
this is the classic in memoriam section of the corporate retreat.
Yeah, so just a moment of silence here.
Little soul, what about me?
Okay, no, I said a moment of silence.
And then DJ Dylan, if you can just play the In Memoriam music.
Yes.
You Yes! Awesome. Man, what a jam. Yes. That pumped me up. Okay.
Yeah, that was really awesome.
That's In Memoriam. All right. Yes. Okay.
R.I.P. Scotty Stotts.
Mm-hmm. R.I.P.
Can't believe we lost you so young.
Yeah. R.I.P. Junka Manila. Junka Manila. Tragic loss. Our you know, thoughts and prayers go out to your family.
Yes.
Which was, you know, whenever we were debating a severance package, we, or whatever you give for this, wow, we had to say no to that one. That's a large family. But, you know, thoughts and prayers.
Well, and we lost so many of your family members already.
Yes.
So.
They could be in the woods still. I'm not sure. And I don't think that that's, you know, on us. We didn't geotag everyone who came. Most people who came, but not everyone.
Yeah, that's just for our geocaching.
Yeah. With the bodies, yeah.
What are we doing, Dr. Linden? I feel like we're just rambling at this point. Well, what's next on the docket? I mean, there's still plenty of living employees. We've done our speeches. We've, you know, done our little conference games. What do we have next?
Well, I mean, one of the reasons I brought up the sort of urine standing, considerable amount of urine here, and the stage made of bodies that we're standing on, is, you know, our next team building exercise also just so happens to be a practical one. We're gonna go ahead and take these buckets. If you could, yeah, go ahead and pass those out. Okay, good. We're going to start taking buckets of urine out, and, you know, we're going to put them in the reservoir. And I know you're thinking, that'll pollute it, that's not okay, but the reservoir is running low, and we have plenty of urine.
And fish do it, that fish are nature.
Yeah, that as well.
And so
you might be saying, as a physician, can you condone this? I will say, shut your mouth and get to work. So just keep doing that. And once again, it's a privilege for you to be here. So let's not make it a whole thing.
Yeah, let's be happy in our attitudes. Now, some of you might be wondering, okay, our buckets are sort of shaped weird. How am I supposed to scoop up the urine off the floor? If you've ever seen someone siphon gas out of a car with a hose, it's going to have to sort of be like that. So you're just going to have to suck up a little bit of the urine off the floor with the hose. And then once you get that going and get a good flow going, then you can sort of like turn the bucket and get a nice flow going through there.
And, okay, next. Sorry, I'm looking at our list and we are kind of behind here. So next we have to make some announcements. So first off, for everyone who brought food, you do have to put that in the pile in the middle here for us to sort through.
Yeah, that's that. I mean, we call it an offering for a reason. You didn't just bring food so what, it could spoil in the cabinet. No, you brought it as a thank you to me and Dr. London so that we can sort through it. And then pick out what we want and then throw away what we don't want.
Some of you had said, I brought this granola bar so I could eat it while hiking, to which I would say, how selfish of you, because we are actually kind of having to ration things here, and we need that for our feast.
And expecting like everyone to be able to hike just on a moment's notice. I mean, we have Siamese triplets here. You think they can just go hiking anytime you just demand them to?
To be honest, you don't know, right?
Exactly.
You're not sure, yeah.
So let me just go ahead and read this list. So, Pamela, Mario, Fisher, Lawrence, Peters, Marshall, Ricky,
Jamie, don't forget Jamie,
Jamer,
mm-hmm.
Rick O, Ricky 2. Ricky 3.
Okay.
Sammy. Twister. Billy. Silly. And Philly. You are fired. you need to leave the premises. I mean, now, right now, the clock is ticking. That's what the clock is counting down to right now. You don't want that to reach zero. Go.
Okay. Go. Yes. Okay. Wow, that went well. I feel like that went really well. You know, I feel like we're really
look
connecting.
Look how fast they ran.
Yeah.
Look how motivated they are. That's all they needed was just a little motivation.
A little motivation. Yeah, and I'm glad that we were able to give that. Sometimes I get so caught up in the work here that I don't stop and just think, you know, about how far we've come over the past these past 4 weeks. And I, you know, sometimes all I see is the road ahead. We have so much time to go. It's a 16-week thing, but we've come so far with this.
I mean, I don't even recognize who I was before we got here. I've completely forgotten about self, ego, in any capacity.
Because you put on a disguise. You've been wearing a disguise since you've gotten here. That's part of it, right?
Oh, yeah. And I couldn't even tell you what I looked like before I put this disguise on. And so now that, which is my disguise? You know what I mean? Isn't my real self now my disguise, truly? And the disguise is my real self?
Yeah, it's a lot of mud, I guess. So, like, my thought is, if it rains, we might just see, like, I feel like it's your disguise. It's not your, but
yeah,
in any case, it could be
so,
whatever.
I mean, in this scenario, it's raining, yet I don't have access to more mud. Okay. That doesn't really make any sense.
You know, I just remembered a critical point that people have been talking about, which is, of course, the hunting. So, whenever we said that Crampy Koala would be joining us for the trip, I guess that everyone was pretty excited because everyone's a huge fan of Crampy Koala. You know,
I know I am.
but you'll notice, yeah. Well, you'll notice that Crampy Koala hasn't been here during his announcements. And that is because, of course, we let him loose in the woods. And that, unrelated to that, no one is allowed to go more than 10 feet, beyond the tree line in the woods anymore.
Yeah, unfortunately, previously it was 15 feet. That's how it normally is on a day-to-day basis, but we are having to sort of reel that in just a little bit to about 10 feet beyond the premises. So your shock collars have been adjusted accordingly.
Yeah, and if you're wondering, you know, who would do such a thing, believe me, at this point, it is for your safety. There's some kind of beast out there, some like horrifically murderous beast, and I don't know how to deal with. Like, I'm glad that we are here. With the shock collars on. I'm glad we brought the shock collars, I guess is what it comes down to.
Yeah, I don't know where I would be if we weren't able to put shock collars on people. I don't think we'd have a podcast, truly. I don't think we'd be able to operate. With the pandemic?
Well, if you go to, Reddit. Well, if you go to Reddit and you ask, you know, in the podcasting subreddit, and you're like, hey, I'm just starting a podcast. What do I need? Every one of them will say, like, maybe they'll mention mics or whatever, but you can do it on your phone. What they'll say is, you're going to need shock collars. And a lot
and
of them.
And get them wet beforehand. So it sort of gives them a little...
It really conducts.
Doctor, I mean, so I hate to interrupt here, Dr. London, but look, I know that we're on a retreat here, and I know that everyone sort of wanted to get away from office life. But I think it might be a mistake if we neglect our chores.
Okay. I thought we were getting away.
I know. Yeah, we are. But think about it. If we don't handle a chore now, then when we get home, we're going to have 1,001 chores rather than just the normal 1,000.
No, I mean, you're right, I guess. So I'm glad that we're out in nature for one thing, which is we can actually fit the chore wheel here. So, you know, normally, let's get, for your prize, employees, for doing so well today, if you want to just sort of flood over and, you know, together as sort of a mob, try to spin that wheel.
If you could just sort of you know, you, all of you are, you know, 5-6 inches tall. If you could just sort of stack on top of each other, World War Z style,
yes,
and then climb up high to give it a good old
but before
spin.
You, so get stacked. But first, Cameron, can you explain what it is?
Absolutely, Dr. London. Look, I'm going to be honest. I'm busy. I'm a busy man. I've got shoes to try on. I've got socks to try off. I've got fishes to pet. And I've got dishes to wet. This is a thing that I say all the time.
Yeah, fishes to pet, dishes to wet.
And unfortunately, Dr. London is also a very busy person as well. And unfortunately, we have let our to-do list, our list of chores, get so long. It's actually longer than my socks that I can't get off my feet. Which, that's crazy to think about, but that's how long our chore list is.
Well, because they get up to your hips,
so,
yeah.
Yeah, to try to spice things up a little bit, we created this chore wheel that we spin every single week in whatever chore it lands on. Whatever chore, even if it's wipe down the TV, even if it's wipe down London's feet, even if it's wipe down the bottom part of London's feet and then put it on TV, well, you have to do it.
Yeah, so, do you know,
how can I get more clear than that?
I just, you know, every time I hear it, I'm kind of relearning every time, and I'm remembering why we do it, but it's too real. Okay, so if you could just go ahead and... Okay, yeah, just fall over and catch it. Good, right there. Oh, no. Ugh. Anything but this, honestly.
On a Monday?
Yeah, apparently. You know, on second thought, I am seeing how there is some practicality to this. That this could actually be a useful chore for us right now. So
the chore.
Well, because I was hoping, that it would be hook up the DVR.
Oh gosh, that would be so nice.
But it doesn't say that.
When I picked up a TiVo when it was new. This was 2002.
Yeah.
And I've been waiting to hook it up, but it doesn't land on the chore wheel. But today we do have to give hunting and wilderness survival tips.
Ugh. Okay. All right. So I'll, you know, if you don't mind, I'll start up. I've got kind of a few that I've been learning and working on, and maybe honing my skills a little bit.
Yeah. Well, and just to even explain a little bit, we have to do this because Dr. London and I are going to be living in the wilderness for, I mean, at least 6-7 hours, and this is something that we are training for right now.
Yeah.
And we're prepping for it.
Yeah.
You know, we're planning to do that here in a few weeks. I'm so glad this came up because otherwise we'd be going out into the wilderness with no preparation.
Yeah, it'd be a little bit more spontaneous. I thought that my sort of instincts would just take over, which is why I was looking forward to it in that way. But I guess a little preparation doesn't hurt.
Yeah, it really doesn't usually. Unless that's intentional, that's part of it. You know?
So, for me, you know, one of the things I've been learning about the wilderness is that if there is a ferocious animal out there that might be sort of a genetically modified koala creature, then which unrelated to crampy koala being around, like that's separate. But if there's a koala creature with, you know, just rows of sharp teeth that are all sort of canines, like all pointed down and just ready to chomp. You have to know how to avoid that. So, one thing, I can give tips on what doesn't work. So, what doesn't work? You can't climb trees to escape it.
Nope. You can't reason with it.
Okay. Yes. That's yours.
It does not adhere to logic or trying to debate it.
You can try, giving it a riddle. Doesn't matter. Still wants to eat you. Like it's yeah. So logic, riddles. What else? Pretty good at handshakes.
Shouting.
Oh, I was gonna say, handshakes work very well.
Really.
Yeah. But it only works if you are making an agreement.
Yeah. It's just, I don't know. You mentioned earlier how so many of our employees are without hands. And is this advice you've been giving out before now? That handshakes are the most effective way to deal with?
Well, yeah. Well, because it's... Yeah, I put together sort of the manual, our survivor manual, and...
Yeah.
I guess, admittedly, I haven't tried it myself, and I haven't seen it sort of in action, but it's one of those things where you think, right. Like... just common sense, I guess, you know?
Yeah, logic, reason.
Yeah, but unlike logic and reason, which actually don't work in the wild, it's the motion, it's a kinetic energy that works. So you can use words all you want and it doesn't do anything. They don't understand, but they understand a physical action, these beasts. So...
Yeah.
So yes, a handshake, a gentle but firm handshake.
Yeah, eye contact.
Yeah, a lot of interview skills are actually going to really come into play here. So.
Oh, yeah. I mean, I think one of the best things you can do if you're being attacked by a wild animal is sort of present positive qualities as if they're a negative. Like maybe sometimes you work too hard or sometimes you are too punctual.
Yeah. And, you want to fudge your resume a little bit? Like...
And they know that. Like, they're expecting it to be sort of exaggerated. Yeah. So don't, you know, feel bad about it. Everyone's trying to present the best version of themselves.
Yeah. So for example, one thing that I do whenever I go into the wild, because you're trying to convey that you have experience in this field, in this case, it might be a literal field. So you might say out loud... Boy, I've been in a field before, and I sure can manage things in this field. So that can work.
And when I go on to the wilderness, the first thing I do is I find the toughest guy there, and I beat him up, which sort of establishes me as the alpha.
Yeah. So, and I should say, so Cameron, you have tried that strategy out, right? Here in the forest?
Yes.
And who was the toughest that you found? Was it the...
The tiger?
Yeah. Yeah, was it the tiger?
Yeah, it was the tiger.
Okay, so you just beat up the tiger?
Yeah. I beat the shit out of him, Dr. London. He came at me, and he was talking smack, first of all. He was saying all sorts of stuff. A lot of stuff about my pants. I was wearing these... extremely large pants at the time.
Well, he said they're great, right?
Yeah, he said he wanted them. He was like, what's the brand? And so I was like...
Well, sorry, he said they're great, right?
Yeah, and then he said, what's the brand? He was really trying to figure out the brand, and that's like the biggest crime you can commit in fashion, Dr. Lennon, is stealing, copying someone else's look. Like, that's my vibe. You get your own.
Yeah, so
I killed him. I killed him with my bare hands. I jumped on him and held him to the ground and choked him out.
Yeah. And so we both had a lot of similar experience in the wild. For me, I didn't actually physically encounter any other creature.
Yeah.
I just sort of established dominance by declaring in an empty field that I've been in a field before. Whereas you similarly... used the wilderness survival approach of just killing a wild tiger with your bare hands.
Yeah. You know what's another good wilderness tip, Dr. London?
Sure. Yeah, go.
Soup.
Soup?
Soup.
Okay, yes. We talking broth?
Anything can be a soup. You can bring it with you anywhere. It's just stuff in water.
Yes.
Okay, yeah. And it can be cold, too. There are cold ones out
there. Yeah, borscht.
Mm-hmm.
So, soup, number one, probably number one wilderness tip. Number one wilderness tip, soup. Number two...
Okay, is interview skills.
Well, tiger tries to copy your look, take him down. Because you can't have that. You have to establish yourself as the dominant alpha. Number three, interview skills.
Yeah, which includes fudging your resume.
Yes.
Which includes a firm handshake, which includes eye contact, and you know, letting them know that you have experience in this field, literally yes. or figuratively, and both work. All right, I feel like that's enough wilderness tips for them to.
I think there has to be one more to bring us home, Dr. London.
Okay.
Like
so.
I don't know, like maybe climb the highest tree that you can find.
Okay, no.
Because there's gonna be I bet there's something really cool up there.
But so we did. That was like the first thing we talked about here, is that you can't climb a tree because there is a creature out there that will get you. But that's
so you have to be really quiet. You have to be really quiet.
Yeah. Okay. I can see that. Okay, so if you are going to climb a tree, do it quietly.
Be really quiet about it. The flimsier it gets, the higher you go, the more interesting the stuff you'll probably find. It's sort of the most important thing. So
yeah, so if you start out with a weaker looking tree, that's going to be more interesting the whole
way. It's going to produce more treasure or gifts or gems or whatever you're trying to find. Yeah. So, you know, you might be up 600 feet and you're swaying in the wind and everything. And you might be thinking, oh, should I keep going? And then just out of the corner of your eye, what are you going to see? You're going to see, oh, a strawberry. Or, oh, look at this leaf that it has it's sort of shaped like Oklahoma.
Or a catfish,
Nev, or whatever his name is.
Yeah, I feel like we nailed it here.
Yeah,
like
I
think we're ready for our hiking.
Okay, so we're just going to go do that now. Y'all have to stay here for the next, 12 more weeks?
Yeah, I believe so.
Yeah, but we're going to go do the adventure thing. We're going to go, you know, be in the wilderness for up to 7 hours before heading home. But y'all hang out here. If you try to leave, callers are going to shock you.
And they will shock you if you try to touch them as well. Yes.
They are called a shocked caller. I don't know why people continue to be confused by this.
Yeah. It seems pretty straightforward. Okay. Anyway, so my name is DrLondonSmith.com. This is our producer, Cameron. Also with us has been Digital in the House. He's been set up in the corner there, really keeping up the vibes.
Yep.
Clap your hands, take it back now, yo. Spin around, stand up, sit down. Take it back now, yo. Do a flip, do another flip. Jump into the air, do the splits. Do the splits.
Do the splits.
Jock Doc Podcast.
See ya.